Every project in this video will start with a lump of clay, 5 or 6 centimeters or a bit more than 2 inches square. It's better to give a lump that's a bit bigger than too small. After all the students have finished step one, hand out small amounts of clay as it's needed because the clay dries out very quickly. Always make sure everyone is working with soft, fresh clay and has enough to work freely. It can limit their creativity if they don't have enough, or to work with clay that is too dry. Some children have difficulty judging the right size and pinching off the correct amount. So samples can be placed on the table as a reference. For younger students, or to save time, before your class starts, you can make all the little balls needed for the various parts. They can be kept moist in plastic or under a damp rag and handed out as needed. That way, everyone has the same amount and all the pieces are all the same size. This is almost necessary for the little ones. However, this does take away some creative freedom, especially with the older students. All the methods for shaping clay have been covered in the introduction. To get started, all you need are some paper towels, some small containers for water, and some round toothpicks. The clay is easily cut with a wire. You can buy a wire at the clay supply store, or you can make your own. This is 30-pound test fishing line tied to a clothes peg. The wire slips through the clay, making measuring and cutting the squares very easy. You'll want to measure down about 6 centimeters, cut it in half, and then about 6 centimeters again to get the size for step number one. The smaller pieces can be made the same way by cutting the clay and taking off the little squares to be handed out as the project progresses, or you can roll the clay and pinch off little lumps all the same size. The clay we use is a school clay with low shrinkage rate, which is very good for air dry projects. Ask your local clay supplier what they would recommend.
Welcome to the Teacher's Corner for the masks projects. Make sure the pancake is large enough to build a face. It's hard to get all the features on a small pancake. If you run out of room and the face is not fitting on the pancake, just add more clay and make the mask bigger. Make sure the face is round and three-dimensional. The chin is often left too flat. Make sure there's paper under the chin and it is round. Often, extra clay is needed for the chin. Check that the edges are as thick as a finger and curled around. Look for flattened edges. Eyes don't have to be cut out, but can be added on. If the eyes are cut out and the holes are too close together, the small amount of clay between them will often crack. Add clay to this area, making the eyes a bit smaller and the space between larger. If you are building larger masks with hair and ears that stick out, build them on a board or a piece of cardboard. It is much easier to move them if they are supported. This video gives instructions in 5 different projects. With the knowledge and skills learned here, it should be fun to see what other masks your students can create.
For this project, we're going to need an extra large ball of clay, about 8 centimeters or 3 inches square, and clay handed out as required. We want to take our little messy ball of clay and turn it into a slab. The first thing we have to do with our little messy ball of clay is rule number one. We're going to have fun with this. We're going to take our messy ball of clay, put it on the table with our hand open, big and flat. We're going to roll it on the table around and around and around. Some people will have problem moving your hand around and around and around. Then you can use your hands and work together to smooth it out. That's one of the guidelines. So we're going to move it around and around on the table using your hand till it goes from a messy ball of clay to a nice tidy ball of clay. Doesn't have to be perfectly round like a baseball, just tidy. After it's tidy, we're going to put it on the paper. Roll on the table, put it on the paper, then we're going to make a fist. Now, no one here has a hammer or a pounder or a banger or a smasher. All those things come out of your whole shoulder. And we're all strong enough to take our fist and go bam right in the middle of that and wreck it. Then we'd have to squish it up and we'd have to start over with rule number two. And that would just affect rule number one. So what we're going to do is we're going to make a tapper. And tappers come out of your elbow. Sometimes it's a firm tap, like a jack tapper. But we're going to gently tap this clay and we're going to tap it into a pancake or a slab. There's just three wee taps and already my ball of clay is flattening out into a pancake. So I'm going to tap and turn and tap and turn, starting from one side, a little bit in, tapping across, and ending before the other side. And then a little bit in, tap and turn, and see how it flattens out into a pancake. You can flatten it out with your hand, you can make it tidy. Gonna tap and turn and tap and turn. Now we have a pancake that's about 15 centimeters wide, or about 6 inches. But what's more important is your pancake is as thick as your finger. If you put it beside, they are the same. We don't have any little tiny skinny flat fingers. We don't have any little tiny skinny flat pancakes. So we've tapped this, we've been it nice and flat and tidy with our hands. We're gonna turn over our paper and turn over our pancake. We have this lovely smooth surface waiting to be made into anything. We're going to work on masks. Now this piece of clay is larger to start off with than the other ones, and so we have to tap it into a bigger pancake. When you want to tap a larger piece of clay into a larger pancake, you need to work on something more sturdy than the paper towel. The paper towel will simply fall apart underneath. So I'm working on a cardboard from a file folder. You could use a piece of printer paper. You can use a larger piece of cardboard. You can use whatever you like as long as it's not the paper towel. So what I'm going to do now is, this isn't quite big enough, but sometimes you're not sure how thick it is when you get a larger pancake. So I'm simply going to just poke the toothpick in and measure it. It's a lot thicker than my finger. So I'm going to tap this out a little bit bigger. Flatten it with my hand. Now I have a nice big pancake that's as thick as my finger all the way through, and it's as thick as my finger on the outside. Okay, now this is the first part of our mask, but we want to give our mask some round. Our faces are very round. If you look at my face this way, it's quite round. If you imagine me laying in a lake with my face above the water, a very quiet lake, and my ears are underneath and everything is underneath the water, we're going to work on just this part of the face. In order to give our face some roundness or some depth, we have to put some paper under there. So one piece of paper at a time, we're going to ball them up and put them under and give our face a nice round profile. Notice I am going one at a time, filling it up, letting it rise, see how it forms. You can't do a lot of papers at once. It just goes into a big blunk in the middle. And that doesn't work. As you start working on your face, it will take on a shape. It sort of tells where the forehead wants to be and where the chin wants to be. Everybody's face is much larger at their forehead than it is at their chin. So as you're stuffing the paper under your pancake, notice you can kind of tell where the forehead is and where the chin's going to be. See, I'm getting this thickness here and it's a bit thinner here. So I'm going to go with that. Okay, now I've got lots of paper under there, but it's not very round. So I'm going to pick it up this way. So you can just curl my fingers around. So I have a nice round face that's laying in the lake with just the face sticking out. So that's going to be our mask. Now if you look at my face, you'll see if I drew a line right down the middle, I have the same amount of things and stuff on this side as I have on that side. This side is equal to that side. So I'm going to draw a guideline gently in the clay. Notice I'm just using the side of my toothpick. I'm not cutting the clay, I'm just making a guideline so I can make this side the same as that side and erase later. And on my face, my eyes are right in the middle. I have as much face above my eyes as I have below my eyes. We don't want anybody with forehead eyes. So again, I'm going to draw a guideline across and about the middle. So then I have a nose, a guideline, and a mouth. And already, it's starting to look like a face. So what I'm going to do now is I'm going to dig his eyes out. Your eyes are about 2 fingers wide. And there's enough room from here to here for 3 eyes. So I have 6 fingers across my face. So if I have a guideline down the middle, and I put 1 finger for measuring, because I want it to be in the middle of the eye that's there, and then 2 for the eye, then I've got an eye spaced away from my guideline, and then 1 for measuring, and 2 fingers. So I've got room for 1, 2, 3 eyes. But we're not going to put an eye there. We have to have that space there to put our nose. So it's getting more and more face-like. Okay, now I'm going to make eyes. At this point, you can make whatever eyes you like, depending on what kind of mask you're making. I'm just going to give him just some basic round eyes, and I'm going to draw them in the guideline. Notice this guideline goes through the eye. A lot of times people will put the guideline and then they'll put their eyes up here anyway. We don't want forehead eyes. So I'm going to draw the eyes at the same time to make sure they're the same. You can trace them because you don't want one big eye and one little eye. Now I have the eyes I want. I'm going to, with my toothpick, just go around that guideline I made and dig his eyes out. This is why you want to measure that it's not too thick. They're very hard to dig out if your clay is really thick. So we're going to do the next one, and we're going to dig his eyes out. I'm going to make them a little bit tidy. Okay, I think we're going to all get to this stage. And when everyone's here, we're going to come back and we'll give this guy some features. We now have our basic template for a mask, just waiting for a face. I start all masks with this basic template. I can change the eyes. You can make round eyes or square eyes or oval eyes. I started off with round eyes. You might want to start off with round eyes, have some practice, and move on from there. But I'm going to start building my face at the top and working down. The first thing we have on our face are our eyebrow bones. We have a big bone above our eye that protects our eye. So I'm going to, with my fingers, just nip off a piece of clay and roll out. One coil of clay is going to be the 2 eyebrows. At this point, you can decide to have big eyebrows or little eyebrows. You can do a unibrow if you like. I'm going to do 2 eyebrows, about the same size. But look what happens. I can give my mask personality with just eyebrows. There he looks kind of happy. Here he's a bit surprised. Now he's angry. And now he's a little confused. I'm going to make my guy happy because I always like to be happy. So I'm going to put my eyebrow bones on, wet and wiggle and twist and stick. And I have the guideline. Notice how I measure each eyebrow from the guideline. I don't have them on off to the side. That's why we have the guideline. So I'm going to put them on. They can be just an eyebrow like that. You can add hair or texture to later, or you can blend them in to be a bone. I'm going to leave mine on as something I can add hair or texture to later. You don't want to add your hair or texture to your eyebrows right now. Okay, next we have on our face is we have our nose. We're going to, with a ball of clay, nip off a piece. Now a big piece of clay will make a big nose, and a little piece of clay will make a little nose. But our nose is a cone. It's just a little cone in the middle of our face with the big part above our lip and the little part between our eyes. We're going to roll it into a cone with our hand at an angle. The one side you roll will get smaller. Tap it down. And you can decide, maybe you want your cone to be a little nose or a big nose. I think I'm going to make this nose a bit smaller, and so I'm going to make it fit the guideline there. These again are your choices. This is your face. This is your mask. You make it the way you like. Wet and wiggle and twist and stick. We're going to give him just a plain triangle nose. And blend it in with a dry finger. Now we want to give this guy some lips. Let's give him cheekbones instead. Cheekbones, again, you have another bone right underneath your eye. And that's another protection bone for your face. I'm going to roll out two cheekbones at the same time and put them on. Now people, when they're smiling, can have great big cheekbones. And when they're kind of sad, their cheekbones are quite a bit smaller. So this guy's going to be in the middle, not happy, not sad. So his cheekbones are going to be in the middle, not big and not really small, but they're right under your eye, above where your nostrils would be. So we're going to glue those cheekbones on, wet and wiggle, and blend them in. When you look at anybody, you can't see where their cheekbones go on. There's not a ball of cheekbone on there. They're blended into the face. I'm going to blend this one in with a dry finger. If you try to blend with a wet finger, it just goes all slidey. So now he's got some cheekbones, a plain nose, and since he's got happy eyebrows, let's give him a happy face. I'm going to roll out a coil of clay, and we're just going to give him I haven't glued it on because I don't know what I'm doing yet. We're going to do it this way. So I'm going to glue it on, wet and wiggle. It's a bit too long. Notice I'm always using the guidelines. I can see where the guideline is to make sure the mouth isn't off to one side. So, and it will be a happy face in a minute. So there's his first lip. And notice this little, what I can do with my thumb is I can just gently push it up here and here, and it gives it a quick little lip mark. And we're going to give him a bottom lip. And again with my thumb, just one thumb mark makes it look like a lip. And the last piece of structure we have on our face is our chin. So we're going to give this guy a chin. I wet and wiggle and blend his chin in, because like your cheekbones, you can't really see where your chin joins on. Okay, now we have our basic face. I want to tidy it up a bit and sponge it. Use a damp sponge when you're sponging. You don't use a really wet sponge, but it works like a called magic wrinkle remover, and it removes all our messy fingers, all the messy fingerprints. And you can sponge our face. You can blend that in a bit more so there's a nice line. Get rid of all your guidelines. If you leave guidelines on the side, they can cause your piece to crack. I'm just going to erase that guideline in there. Give him a little more of a smile. And very quickly, we have our just a basic face. So we're going to stop here and let everyone get to this stage. And then we're going to come back and we're going to change this just a little bit. We have our mask and it's nice, but I think we should give him a bit more character. His eyebrows, what if we gave him sort of ripped off his eyebrows? That's gotta hurt. Let's give him bigger eyebrows. And we're gonna wet and wiggle and twist and stick. Give him bigger eyebrows. And let's get some hair in his eyebrows. These sculpting sticks make wonderful hair. Looks better already. Okay, now he's got, his eyes are little. What if you made them a little bit bigger? Just a little bit bigger. And this is kind of fun, because now we can put eyeballs in his eyes. There's nothing wrong with the simple mask, but sometimes it's fun to go a little bit past that. You can dig that out. If you were going to do this, you would start off with the larger eyes, the larger circles to begin with. To make eyes, we're going to make two little balls the same size. And you can have fun with his eyes. He can be cross-eyed. He could be looking here. He could be looking up here. He could be looking sideways. Any way you like him. I'm just going to put my guys in the bottom like this. I'm going to go fairly quickly. You guys will take your time. And we're going to give him some eye in there. That's kind of fun. And let's give him, oh, poor guy. Let's rip his lips off. That's gotta hurt. And give him some nostrils and a bigger nose. So to make the nostrils, we're going to roll two balls of clay the same size. And wet and wiggle on the outside of his face, because we have nostrils on the side. And then we have that little thing that goes right up the middle of our nose. So we're going to make a little coil to build one of those. And we're going to wet and wiggle, twist and stick. Now we're going to blend those pieces in. So it does look fairly nose-like. But what we're going to do is we're going to give him his nostrils. Everybody has these holes in the nose. And what I want to do is with my little finger, I'm going to wet my finger, I'm going to stick it in there. If it makes you feel better, you can say, excuse me, and stick that one in there. So now he's got big nostrils on his nose. One more thing we can do to make his nose look like a nose is with the side of this. We can give him just those nostril lines. So now he's got his nose, and he had a nice, quiet little closed mouth. Let's give this guy an open mouth. So I'm going to open this up, and I'm going to cut the mouth out the same way we did the eyes. I'm just going to dig his mouth out. Now we can give him some lips. Now you can roll your lip to be just a plain coil like we did. Or you can roll your lip and at this side of it, you can with your hand make it tapered. So it's kind of shaped skinny on one side and fat on the other. Put the skinny side under his nose. And wet and wiggle, because our mouth is quite round. We have teeth under our lips, so let's give them some roundness. With our thumbs, we can give him those lips, and we'll give him a bottom lip. Wet and wiggle. I want that lip bigger. If you don't like what you're making, change it. Give him a bigger bottom lip. That's too big. There we go. Again, with your thumb in the middle, you can give it some lip marks. Blend those in. His chin, maybe he wants a bigger chin. We can add some more clay to the bottom. You can see, with after you've made your basic face, you can have a lot of fun with this. At this point, there's no rules. As long as it's as thick as your finger. Now, what if I wanted to give this guy some hair? I'm going to blend that in. If I want to go past the mask, you have to make sure you are working on the cardboard. And we're going to give him some hair. Now, you can do hair a few ways. We can do hair right on him if you want. You can do hair, just straight pieces of hair. You can twist them a little bit so they kind of look like dreads for hair. You can do what I call hat hair, just put some on the top and with your stick add some texture like you've done the eyebrows. You can see you can really play with this. You can do hair down the side of his face. I think I'm going to give him hair down one side, couple in the middle. And notice I'm seeing if I like it before I glue it on. It's a lot easier to see if you like it and glue it on than to glue it on, not like it, and take it off. I think we'll go with that. And then one more down the other side. If you're going to get your hair big, some people might want to go a lot bigger. You'll have to make sure, like if you wanted to do or even horns on this guy, if you wanted to, make sure they're as thick as your thumb. Little pieces of clay sticking out there are going to be very easily broken. So if you're going to do big pieces of hair or horns or whatever sticking out, make sure they're nice and thick. So now I've wrecked his hair. We're going to give him just hair that looks like that. And I'll put some texture in it. And it's bigger than the pancake. And I'll show you what to do in just a second. This isn't my favorite hair, but. So now I've got pieces attached to him that are bigger. His hair is bigger. His chin is bigger. I want to very gently turn him over and make sure all those pieces are blended in. So they're all blended in. We want to make sure his chin is all blended in. And now's a good time to make sure that he's nice and thick, that the whole mask around the base is as thick as your finger. So now he's got messy fingerprints on it, so I'm going to, again, with my sponge, a little bit of water, sponge this off, make him tidy. I think he wants one of those chins. He did. So we can sponge them off, and then the last thing we're going to do is come back for our project check. Now, before the project check, I was looking at this guy and I didn't like his hair, so I changed it. If you don't like your project, change it. We had the hair made with a sculpting stick with this side. I want to use this side. It makes the, I like it. It gives him more of what I call hair flare. So we use that side. And I tidied up his eyes. This was pretty messy in here. So again, with this little stick, I just tidied up his eyes. I made sure his nose was tidy. And so now we're ready for the project check. Again, I want to make sure that these parts are all blended, that his hair is not going to fall off. After we gave him that new hairdo, he doesn't want it to fall off. His chin is attached. The paper is still inside. It's nice and thick along here to hold him up forever. I've sponged his messy parts off. He's got lips. He's got a smile. We're going to put some holes in the side so we can put a string and hang it on the wall. You won't actually wear this mask, but you'll hang it on the wall. So now he's got holes. When you make your holes, make sure the clay comes out. Quite often it stays in there and your hole stays clogged. So as a part of your project check, make sure your holes are all open and free of clay. He's sponged, he's tidy, he likes his hair. Now he's ready for drying. When clay is wet, it has water in it. What happens to the clay when it dries and all the water goes away? Clay shrinks when it dries. If it dries quickly or unevenly, it can crack or even break. When the projects have been completed, place them all together on a flat surface. Larger pieces need some special attention. They need to be compressed or compacted to hold them together. You want to just squeeze the body and squish them together. If they aren't compressed or compacted, they will break. When they do break and they're still wet, you can just simply put them back together by wet and wiggle, score and twist and stick. Now you want to lightly cover the projects with a plastic sheet or garbage bag overnight to allow them to equalize. This just means the moisture content in the big and the little pieces reaches the same level. The next morning when you uncover them, do a quick project check and fix any problems that might have shown up overnight. This mask is firm enough I can take the paper out. You want to make sure his eyes are loose at the back, are not going to fall out. You can smooth him out if he's a bit messy. As long as the clay is even just a little bit wet, you can repair most problems. Leave the projects uncovered for about 4 hours and then cover them again through the second night. After that, they can be left open to dry completely. Before you paint, you want to make sure your clay is dry. It will change color from dark to light. When the project has turned color all over, it's time to paint. If you're unsure, it's better to take an extra day or two for drying than to let them dry too quickly. Drying times will vary. Now the projects are dry, you can use one of two finishing methods: painting the air-dry clay or firing it in a kiln. All the projects in this series can be air-dried, so let's see how we can paint them. We suggest painting be a team activity with the students working in pairs.
For the initial paint applications, one student can hold a project so its bottom's facing up, and the other student can apply paint. The paint dries rapidly, so the student can hold the project for a few minutes before setting it down on the paper. Apply two coats of paint to the bottom and up the sides a bit and allow it to dry. Once all the bottoms are done, the students can work on their own. Now that the bottom is dry, turn the project over and with the dry bottom side down, apply two coats to the top. The acrylic paint will soak into the clay. It's better to use more paint than less. The best paint for this type of project, believe it or not, is the cheapest type you can buy, usually at a big box or discount store. The reason is these cheaper paints are already thinned, and they go much further than the expensive paints. Choose one color to paint the entire project, and when it's dry, you can decorate and accent with different colors. For example, when painting a caterpillar, paint the entire piece green, and then add colored trim. All surfaces must be generously covered. Now, if a piece of the sculpture should come loose, as has happened with the caterpillar's little foot here, there are at least two ways of reattaching it. If it's a flat piece, you can use paint as glue. Put a blob between the pieces and stick. If the pieces are not flat, paint both surfaces, allow them to dry, then glue gun them together. After the glue sets, paint again. Glue will stick to painted surfaces, but not to the bare clay surface. Now we've painted our caterpillar with two generous coats of acrylic paint all in one color, and the real fun can start now. This is where you begin to make the project really your own. You can take a contrasting color, like the yellow that Cindy's using here. You can paint his eyes. You can paint on his spikes, for instance. The big thing is to use your imagination. There's nothing that says more, this is my caterpillar, than what you do with the paint.
We can paint his toes.
Could paint his toes. Not red. Oh, we're painting them brown, so he's going to have brown toes.
It's a him, so we're not going to paint his toes red.
Okay.
We can paint his toes brown. You can add a little bit to your leaf. Thin colors. If you brush it on thin, it has a bit of a different color. Make your stem a different color. I'm going to paint his toes over here brown.
So you get the idea. If you've got several different colors, just remember that sometimes less is better than more. You can go crazy with decorating and then you wind up with a really funny looking caterpillar. But it is your project. The biggest thing is to remember rule number one and have fun.
There, now he'll look at you.
When the paint is dry, you should spray the projects with the low-odor clear gloss sealant. Now, it's better to have an adult spray seal the projects after the students have finished painting them and the paint is dried. We suggest you cover a table with paper and seal all of the projects at the same time. As we said, the sealant should be low-odor, meaning it does have a bit of an odor. However, it's not harsh at all and it will dissipate quickly. When applying the sealant, as with the paint, seal the bottom first by turning over the project and spraying. Try to place the project so only the bottom is sprayed, and the sealant cannot stick to the paper. Allow the bottom to completely dry for a minimum of at least 1 hour. Elevate the project on something smaller than the diameter of the bottom, for example, coins or broken pieces of a wooden craft stick, and spray, trying not to let the project touch the paper. Once the project is completely sealed, allow it to dry overnight. The projects actually toughen up over the next 2 or 3 days. If the sealant sticks to the paper and removes some paint revealing the clay, and this will happen from time to time, simply reapply the paint to the spot and spot seal it again. The projects are now finished and can be sent home.
The projects are sturdy and can be washed with a damp cloth and should provide years of memories.